We are now recording. So, Donna, would you like to start us off? I have my PowerPoint presentation ready, and we can go from there, okay?
Brilliant. Absolutely brilliant. Welcome everybody to this session that Simon's put together for us all. I'm sure that we'll all learn plenty from it. I wanted just to share a few videos with you of different performances, and some of them are performances where the performers are almost over the edge. They're certainly on the edge of the cliff, but they've not quite gone over the edge, but they're almost there. So I want to share, there's a couple that I want to share first of all, and then we'll discuss, not everybody, because I think there's about 5 million people in this room. So
It's
if there's a
official.
few
I think
people,
it is just past the 5 million
just
mark,
past the
Donna.
5 million,
5 million
okay.
and one.
So
Yeah.
if a couple of people want to make any comments about the videos that I'm going to show, then that will be brilliant. Okay, so my glamorous assistant, Mr. Simon Lubkowski, and I
I'm
will say
many
it
things,
different
Donna.
every time.
Glamorous. I feel like Debbie McGee, but I don't really look like her. That's showing my age, isn't it? Some of you will know Debbie McGee. Some of
It
you will be
is,
like, you
yeah.
have no
If
ideas. Here
we
we
can
go.
start with Signature
Yep, we can
Quartet
indeed.
singing Dance with My Father. Have a tissue.
Okie doke. Let me just share my computer sound. We should be fine. Can everyone see my screen? Excellent. If you download the PowerPoint yourself, we're going to signature first video, Dance with My Father. Here we go. Have a
Thank
listen
you,
and
Simon.
enjoy.
Father again, again, and some Sometimes I listen outside her door. Outside her door. And I hear how my mother cried for him. I pray for her even more than me. Dying to dance with my father again. Every night I fall asleep, and this is all I ever dream. Lord, that's all I'm asking. Let me dance with my father.
Well, that was, it's just an amazing performance. I'm sure that there'll be a lot of people out there who have seen that before. It's a perfect example of all of them, all four of them being emotionally involved in the song right from the very, very beginning. You could feel it as well as hear it. When he gets to, when the big guy at the back, the lead singer, when he gets to that part where he just sort of is teetering over the edge, he's almost gone, almost. And somehow in those few seconds, he manages to bring it back and start singing again without ruining his vocal quality. He still sounded as good at the end as he did at the beginning and going all the way through. I don't think that I would be able to get that far over the edge without actually falling. It's mm-hmm. just such a powerful, powerful piece. Not to mention that it's a brilliant song anyway, but yeah, it's you could feel the pain. You could feel the pain that he felt on behalf of his mum, right the way through that. It's beautiful. Is there anybody here who's not seen that before who'd like to pass comment or say anything about it? Simon, are you invigilating? Can you see hands?
I'm on two screens, but I will keep a little bit of an eye. I'll keep a little bit of an eye.
Yeah.
I'm going between two screens.
I can see Jane with a hand up.
Yeah. Jane, if you want to unmute yourself.
I have done. I've heard Luther Vandross millions of times, But that beat him hands down. It was very, very emotional the way it was done. It was just amazing. I didn't think anybody could sing it as good as Luther.
No, you don't think that until you see Signature. Yeah, it's amazing. But it's Simon's put it in the PowerPoint, and we'll all be able to watch it over and over again. No need to search through YouTube to try and find it.
We'll all cry over and over again.
It's an interesting one that it's 6 minutes long. And for me, a measure of how effective a performance sometimes is how long it seems like it is. And it does, it never seems to me like a 6 minute song. Sometimes a song that isn't particularly great, 2 minutes can seem like an absolute eternity in something which isn't very engaging. Those 6 minutes for me always go pretty quickly. It doesn't seem like a 6 minute song. So,
yeah.
Do you want me to move on to the next one, Donna?
Yes, please. Yeah, the next one is, this is totally, it's exactly the same insofar as we're going to watch a quartet be on the brink of the cliff, but they deal with it in a totally different way. This is GQ, and the song is called Where Do You Start? It is fabulous, and it's led by the tenor. Enjoy it.
Just a very quick one before I press play. If people try and get into the are in the waiting room during a video, I can't admit them without the video stopping. Just in case you're worried if any of your friends, on the previous song, I couldn't let some people in because if I did that, it would stop the video, and that would definitely affect the emotional impact if I stop and allow people in and then restart the video. So just in case you think I'm ignoring your friends who are in the waiting room and I'm not letting them in because they're a little bit late, I'll let them in at the end of this song so I can play this song in its entirety.
Separate the present from the past. How do you deal with all the things you thought would last? That didn't last. With bits of memories scattered here and there, I look around and don't know where to start.
Bits of memories everywhere.
I don't know. Which tapes and dreams belong to you and which are mine? Our lives are tangled like the branches of a vine that intertwine. So many habits that will have to break, and yesterdays will have to take apart. One day song or something in the air again to catch me by surprise, and you'll be there again. A moment in what might have been.
In love again, I promise there will always be a little place no one will see, a tiny part deep in my heart that stays in love with you.
Yeah, what did you think of that? Yeah, I mean, that is just an amazing performance. The similarities between both songs for me is that when the lead is performing, or the tenor in that case, but the person who's singing the melody, and when the other three are not actually singing, they're looking at her in that case, or him in the previous one, as though they're telling the most important story that you will ever hear. They're the person who's singing is the most important person in the world, and what they've got to say is just fantastic, and they're just drinking it all in. It's just a superb performance. Has anybody got anything that they'd like to say about that? Has anybody seen that performance previously, apart from Simon? Has any? No?
There's a couple of nods.
Is that?
There's more shaking heads than nods.
Yeah.
I've got one thing, Donna, if that's all right.
It is.
That song for me, Signatures as well, that song for me is, there's quite a lot in this song at the beginning of You Will Be Found, for example, where there is quite a long time where you don't sing, where a lot of the parts don't sing. And the question of how you get emotionally involved in a song where you're not actually singing the words. That song there, GQ, is a really good example of how to be emotionally involved when you're not singing the words.
Yeah, I didn't right necessarily from the beginning.
I didn't necessarily notice the other singers. I think we said earlier when we were chatting and we were talking about this, they're like supportive friends. Kind of, it's like looking on at your friend who you want to support, but you know you can't change anything. And but it's subtle. But again, that one's really useful for how we kind of access, we listen to the tune, we get in the zone into that storytelling. And again, with You We Found, I think that's what, for a lot of us, possibly is the thing to look at for those first 23 bars, to get into the story.
Yeah.
Mike's got his hand up, Donna.
Yes.
For me, whenever I see a featured part, I actually immediately go to the supporting people, because I need to know that they're in the game as well, that they seem sincere. And so, because it's a quartet. So for me, it's just automatic. It's not on purpose. I get drawn to people who are not doing the thing. And then I think to myself, do they look like they're really in the game or not? And the girls there were like there. They were present.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
They're totally focused on that lead. So I didn't have to worry about it. It didn't break the picture, the fabric of what was being established.
No.
Yeah.
So no. Mm-hmm. Really, really successful.
Jane, did you want to say something?
Yeah, just to sort of, it would carry on from what Mike was saying. I mean, they were all looked like they were all totally engaged in what was happening. But I thought the baritone particularly was looking at her as if she was checking whether she was going to cry, or she was actually checking how she was being affected, as in a motherly sort of way. And I thought that was even a more complex way of showing the support and the engagement in the whole song.
Yeah, the baritone in that one is the tallest of the group. Yeah. I think you mean
The tallest.
It is quite, again, she kind of, she's looking around to kind of check she's all right. Looking around to check that she's all right. Now, the interesting, and you may all have your own opinions on this, but the interesting thing is that something that was on the spur of the moment, or is that something that was planned as part of a performance? Mm. For us as an audience, I don't think it actually matters if it's successful. So if that was something that they planned, possibly it was something that happened spontaneously, and possibly they decided that was something that was would stay in the performance, or it was spontaneous on the spur of the moment. And again, really, we can think about things. Again, people have said about the signature one that, therefore, was it planned? Was it planned that they were going to have that massive big gap and silence in the middle of the song? Mm-hmm. And again, personally, I don't think necessarily they knew that they'd get that far off the cliff. Otherwise, it was a very interesting call. But again, as an audience member, for me as a listener, it doesn't matter because it's successful. You can tell, I can tell sometimes when things are planned and it breaks that spell. But in neither of those two performances would the spell broken for me. It was just both of them are captivating in their own way.
Yeah, and in both performances, every single member was in it right from the very beginning.
Yeah.
Which is especially for anybody other than the tenors and the basses, that's very important for in our current song that we can do that. So
you ready for the contrast?
Yeah, we've got a contrast because it's not all about sad songs.
No,
you know, it's about performance and it's about drawing people in to your performance so that they want to watch it. They want to watch you perform. They want to know what you've got to say, how you're selling the story and telling the story. And this is a song that we probably all know. It's been done very differently from the original, but it is fabulous. And for me, as soon as it starts, within a second, I'm drawn in and I want to watch it and I want to know what happens next and I want to know how they're going to deliver this song. So, Maestro.
Here we go.
Hit the button.
It's not the it's not the thing I'd think of when I think of barbershop, but here we go.
Did we just lose Simon?
Indeed,
oh dear.
We did.
I am back. Hopefully you can hear me.
Okay,
can you
cool.
hear me?
Yes.
Yes.
Excellent. Cool. I'm just reloading. No idea what happened there. I'll just have to share my sound again. 1 second. Everyone there?
I'm glad it's not just me.
Yeah, nah, it just happens sometimes. 60 people in a video room sometimes happens. Here we go.
Da, 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 da. Strangers to love, you know the rules, and so do I. A full commitment's what I'm thinking of. You wouldn't get this from any other guy. I just want to tell you how I'm feeling, girl. I gotta make you understand. Never gonna give you up, never gonna let you down, never gonna run around and desert you, never gonna make you cry, never gonna say goodbye, never gonna tell a lie and hurt you, baby. We've known each other for so long. Your heart's been aching, but you're too shy to say it. Yeah, inside we both know what's been going on. We know the game and we're gonna play it, baby. If you just ask me how I'm feeling, don't tell me you do. Blind to see, never gonna give you up, never gonna let you down, never gonna run around and desert you. I'm never gonna make you cry, never gonna say goodbye, never tell a lie and hurt you.
Never gonna give, never gonna give, never gonna give, never gonna give.
Would you give a dollar?
Oh, yeah.
Or would you give a hug?
But there's one thing I wouldn't give, and that's you up. Bow, bow, bow.
Would you give a kidney?
Oh, yeah.
Or would you give a car?
Oh, and though I know that giving is an essential part of living, the only thing I wouldn't give is you, my love. Never gonna give you up.
Never gonna
let you down. Never gonna run around and desert you. Never gonna make you cry. Never gonna say goodbye. Tell a lie and hurt you. Never gonna give you up. Never gonna give you up.
brilliant. It's absolutely brilliant. Yeah, it is. It's just fantastic. Newfangled Four. Somebody commented, it said that they saw them last year. Donna, not me, a different Donna, and said it was spectacular. The thing about this performance for me is that that seemed to last about 30 seconds, that song, and I know that it lasted a lot longer. It was full of energy. It was energetic right from the very beginning. It drew us all in. And the one thing that I want to say about this song and make a slight comparison to You Will Be Found is that the energy at the end of the song was as much as the energy at the beginning of the song. And with You Will Be Found being 6 minutes long, it's not the easiest task to keep that energy up there right the way throughout. And I think that we can probably learn a little bit from the new, well, we could learn a lot from the Newfangled Four, can't we? From this particular song, that just remind ourselves that we do need to keep the energy level right up there, not just when we first come in, but right the way through to the to the cymbal at the end. That's the cymbal, by the way, if you've not been in my sessions previously. who wants to talk about the Newfangled Four and Never Gonna Give You Up? Somebody must have something to say about that.
Song of my youth. Carol Lubkowski has her hand up.
And you said her name right.
Well, you know.
Hello. Hi, everyone.
Hi, Carol.
What impressed me about that was that there was a real kind of comic element in it, and yet the professionalism of them all, and the way they were all, the timing was perfect with one another, wasn't it? And so it really was a very clever performance. Yeah, it was.
Yeah, very. Yeah. Anybody else? I can only see one page.
Yeah, I'll go second page and see. I think we're okay.
Mike's got his hand up.
Oh, yes, Mike.
Yes.
If there are any guys here in this audience wondering about whether they're fit enough to do that last chord, you can just forget it. That's so high, it doesn't really exist. It's
the abundance
of
youth, basically,
mate.
A mixed quartet who just all four happen to be men. Yeah, they do sing
absolutely.
A little bit of a,
it's
quite
super
a high,
high
key, don't they? Yeah, it is super high.
Yeah. Yeah, I thought I'd throw that in just as a bit of information, people.
Thanks, Mike.
You're
Thank
most
you.
Welcome.
Donna, I'm going to ask a favour. I'm going to ask a favour, Donna. Can we, for time-wise, could we skip the fourth song? I'm looking at time. We're about half an hour in and we are...
We can.
Yeah, is that okay? It is in the PowerPoint.
Yeah, this is absolutely standard for me.
Oh,
using 50 words when one is when one is more than enough. Yes, it will be on the PowerPoint.
Yeah, the fourth song is one that's on the PowerPoint, and it's a live performance of This Is Me from The Greatest Showman, but the one that was done on a green light for the actual getting the film made. Some things that you may have seen before, but from a visceral kind of performance, again, it's really, really successful. So do have a look at the PowerPoint, but I just wanted to do that. So thank you very much, Donna. I think that is Donna's bit so far, folks.
Thank you.
So,
it is. Thank you very much, Donna. I hope you enjoyed that selection of videos. Thank you. See
excellent,
you soon.
Excellent. We are moving on to Debbie and Laura, I think.
It is. Debbie, you with me? Yep.
She needs to unmute herself, yeah.
I thought it was Mike next, so I was, you know, chilled.
Nah, it's okay. No, that's fine. It's you.
It's me, okay. Well, I'm here to represent the criers and the plummeters and the people who fall off the edge of the cliff with absolutely no control whatsoever. A lot of everybody's nodding like this. If you've been in my sessions, you'll know I am a crier, unfortunately. When I went to see Titanic, somebody fetched the first aider because they thought I was having some sort of seizure. So I really, really, a crier. So I just want to talk a little bit about that. When I finish, Laura is going to leap in and try and give you some tips on how to not do that. So when you get to the seaside, while the non-emotive people are still putting the money in the car park, I have charged to the end of the cliff and leapt in, and I'm on the rocks below. So I don't have any trouble engaging with the song. I do have trouble trying to not fall over the end. And if it's a song that I can't connect with, because you can't connect with all of them, then I have to try and find a bit of my life that I can link it to. So with the Dear Evan Hansen, because I'm not an 18-year-old boy, just to put that out there, I have to try and link it to something that I feel. And for me, that song is all about the collective and all about how that's picked me up in these dark times. So I'm not actually sure how I'm going to do the recording without plummeting over the edge, because it's so apt for me at the moment and for all of you, I'm sure. So that's going to be interesting, whether I actually manage to submit a recording without it being, you know, snotty.
Yeah, I was going to say snotty. So there's going to be some snotty recordings, I think.
Yeah, absolutely. So what happens when you do fall over the edge is, yeah, there's a lot of snot. If anybody's ever seen the film Truly Madly Deeply, Juliet Stevenson spends the entire film covered in snot, and it's really not pretty. I mean, that film works because Alan Rickman is like the divine, but it's awful. Her nose runs, her eyes run. So nobody really wants to see that. And it's also not very, very good vocally either if you topple over the edge, which you're just about to see a prime example of that. There's been lots of examples on how to do it right, lots of fabulous examples on how to do it right. So the example on how not to do it right is going to be me. Not live, I'm not going to sing it live, but there's a recording of me plummeting over the edge quite early on in the song, actually, and completely unable to get it back. So it's a song by a composer called Stephen Sondheim, if any of you know him. He has an uncanny knack of reaching into your soul and pulling it out and stamping on it a little bit. Fantastic songwriter, but really, you know, really heartfelt stuff. And it's from a musical called Follies, which is full of fabulous, fabulous songs, but there's not a lot of mirth in it. It's a pretty sad show from start to finish, I have to say. And the context of the song doesn't matter because it just stands on its own. It works very well in the show, but it stands on its own anyway. So Stephen Sondheim's songs are a bit like alcohol, a bit like drinking. They tell you never to drink on your own at home, and I don't think you should sing Stephen Sondheim songs on your own at home. Not when you live in Leicester and you're in lockdown and you can't see any of the people you love. It was a very, very stupid thing I did, but hey-ho, here we go. So if you want to have a think through it, what I could have done differently, apart from not sing the song, and then at the end of it, what's going to happen is Laura's going to put my life right. Is that right, Laura? So I apologise for the snot. If I turn my camera off, it's because I can't bear to watch myself do it all over again. Let's see. So could the glamorous assistant, or the assistant, please press the button?
Here we go. I'll make sure I share my sound. Oh, 1 second.
The sun comes up, I think about you. The coffee cup, I think about you. I want you so, it's like I'm losing my mind. The morning ends, I think about you. I talk to friends and think about you. And do they know it's like I'm losing my mind? All afternoon, doing every little chore, the thought of you stays bright. Sometimes I stand in the middle of the floor, not going left, not going right. I dim the lights and think about you. Spend sleepless nights to think about you. You said you loved me, or were you just being kind? Or am I losing my mind?
There you go.
All afternoon, doing every little chore, the thought of you stays bright. Sometimes I stand in the middle of the floor, not going left, not going right. I dim the lights and think about you, spend sleepless nights to think about you. You said you loved me, or were you just being kind? Or am I losing my mind?
Wow, how do you follow that? That was something special. I think knowing you and then watching that video, it really touched me. Thank you so much for sharing that, Debbie. Jill's got her hand up. Hey, Jill.
I just wanted to jump in and say that before that was played, I was expecting Debbie to sing, basically. She'd gone over and she wasn't going to be able to sing. And for me, the singing was fantastic and the emotion was a huge part of that. And for me, it didn't affect the quality of the singing. It was perfect. I really enjoyed it. I thought it was a brilliant performance.
Yep, I would agree. Donna, you've got your hand up.
Yeah, I agree absolutely with Jill there. I was expecting just Debbie to be a complete blubbering wreck and to not be able to speak or not be able to sing, but you've got a beautiful voice, Debbie. Just gorgeous. Thank you.
Yeah. I would say there was maybe two notes in that entire piece that was affected with your crying. And out of a whole song, that's really good going. So no, you don't need fixing for that song. Tuesday's got her hand up. Hey, Tuesday.
I just want to say I've actually been watching that specific song recently because it's one that's very close to my heart. And I have, I mean, looked at performances by all sorts of people that have been, bleh. That one gave me chills. I'm blown away.
Yeah, I would agree.
It was really, really special.
I would just like to say as well, well done for being so vulnerable in front of the camera and then feeling safe enough to share it with the collective. You know, there's a couple of us. So it's a great honour that you've shared it with us. So,
62.
Yeah, but now you're putting it on YouTube.
Oh, no. Thousands and millions, yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, how do I follow that? So, what makes us connect with the song? It's a good thing to have an emotional connection with a song. And if you feel it very deeply, that's also useful. And it's good that you can connect to music that way. You know, you're doing the right thing becoming a singer. So, if you do get emotional, that's okay. But we need to learn how to harness that so we can use it to add to the performance rather than it affecting vocal tone or vocal quality, or that you start feeling sorry for the singer rather than being with them in the emotion of the song? Because there is a fine line that's quite easy to cross there. So what do we connect with? For me, it could be a lot of different things. It could be a memory, because music will take us back to anywhere in our life. You know, it will bring us right back to a person, a place, a thing, anything. So it could be a memory. It could be the chord progressions. I know Simon mentioned in his session yesterday that certain chords will get the chills going instantly. Or it could be a progression of notes. You know, the rising and falling of the melody line could just really, or the bass line, but it could really just pull us into that emotional place. But it could be the words. It could be the story that they are telling. Or it could just be that day. And that's okay. Some days I can listen to any song under the, you know, under the sun, anything. Other days, yeah, no sad playlist, no country music. I've learned that one. I remember at work, I spent an entire day listening to female country, and I couldn't work out why I was so depressed by home time. So I wouldn't recommend that one. So we need to think about what it is in us that will make us connect, and then we can work with it. So there's a few ideas I have for working with these difficult emotions. And first thing is accepting them. And that is you, and that is okay. You know, it's fine to feel that way with a song. I would suggest trying to find a similar emotion, like Debbie was saying there with the You Will Be Found. She can't relate to the lead character of Dear Evan Hansen. For me, I don't want to go to the dark place thinking about Dear Evan Hansen. So for me, it's about helping a friend through something. If you've been to any of my sessions, you wouldn't see your friend upset and go over and go, "Hey, I notice you're upset." You would bring the tone right back and you go, "Are you okay?" So that is a way that I have found I can work with the opening tenor bass solo, so that it's something similar. The audience will still feel the same effect, but you know what you're thinking about and you can convey that message to the audience. Even if we are just sitting at home recording our audio and then lip syncing later on to a Zoom, we still need to perform at every stage. Mm-hmm. The first time you listen to a song, make sure you're somewhere safe. Make sure you're, I don't know, at home. Or make sure you're at your chorus rehearsal where you know that everyone will be connecting at the same time with the song. Don't leave it to the last minute. I've seen people that have gone, right, I know this song, it's great. And then on stage, they finally connect with it. So make sure you know the places that may affect you in different days under the stress of competing. Or performing in general, make sure you have that contingency plan of where you can, I don't know, distract yourself from the feelings. So that takes me to my next bit of distraction. It was suggested in one of my sessions that their chorus, think of goldfish in a tank. You'll have seen Bertie's post on the Facebook page. We go like that in our sessions. If we can think of, she's showing us our goldfish. But if we can distract our brain away from that edge, thinking of goldfish, thinking of something that will take you to a slightly happier or safer place will really help. Some people might pinch themselves, you know, even just on your side of your leg, just to go, no, you're okay, you've got this. Make sure you're kind to yourself in these emotional situations. We're all human and we all feel things. And especially just now, it's a tough time. So make sure you're not going too far over that edge and make sure you have people around you if you do. Another good tip is acting. how would someone else feel in that song? Put on a character. Distract your mind from your inner feelings and say, well, how would they do this? And even if it's just for that song, it might help you to keep it in control throughout the performance. So I would just like to ask everyone, you don't have to, but if you found anything that has worked for you, please feel free to put it in the chat, because if it's worked for you, it's worth everyone giving it a shot, because we don't know what works for us until we find it. So that is my section of it. I hope you've gained something, but just remember to be kind to yourself. Don't do something that doesn't feel good.
Yeah. Okay. Agreed. Laura and Debbie, folks. Laura and Debbie. Very good. Very nice. Yeah, I think I said exactly the same thing, Laura, in my live arranging thing, which I'd never done before. And I just said, I have to be kind to myself when I'm being creative. Whether it be arranging or that it be singing or performing, you have to be kind to yourself at all times. And we are our own worst critic, and we beat ourselves up far more than other people do. And when we're on our own, when we've not got those people there, it's why lockdown's so difficult. We sometimes, we overthink, we overworry, and we get ourselves all in a tizzy. And it's easy to jump off that cliff when you're on your own. So. But no, thank you so much. Now, folks, we are moving on to Mike Savarin. Mike Savarin. I'm also looking at the comments. What I will do, folks, is I will save this comment thread, and I will therefore take out some of these little things that you're saying and things that you use. I'll save the comment thread, and I'll put that into a little document as a little lots of tips and things. So do feel free to put them in there. Don't worry if you don't read them all. I will make sure that I save them and put them up. The comments, not just the random stuff. So the ideas and stuff, if you pop it in there, I'll then pop it out as the comments of this session. Okay, so now thank you very much. Mike, it's up to you, my friend. I can't hear you, Mike.
Because I've got a secondary microphone.
There
sorry.
You go, mate. There you go.
Sorry about that. Welcome, people. Following on immediately from what's been said there, I've seen something in the chat thread from Denise Patch relating to finding and showing emotion during songs. Some people find that quite difficult. Some people don't. Debbie, our Debbie Neath is obviously one person. And, you know, it's easy for us to actually show no emotion at all, to be quite honest. Have you ever felt like nobody was there? Have you ever felt forgotten in the middle of nowhere? Have you ever felt like you could disappear? Like you could fall and no one would hear? Now, it's really not very engaging, is it? You know, strictly speaking, you know, we're just singing and there's nothing really happening with the face. No real exchange of expression from the opening right to the end of the line, really. What I'm going to be trying to discuss is how we energize ourselves, how we go from that place to this place. Have you ever felt like nobody was there? This is where we need to be. We need to be in a different place. And there are a number of ways of getting here, to be quite honest. But as time precludes me from going through them all. But really, I like to start with getting the person who I'm talking to, or the session people who are listening, to understand exactly what they're doing right now, and then bring attention to those things, and then give tips to solve those things. And the biggest surprise from people is that you hear all the time, the shock all the time is, but I was doing loads. I was really energized, man. There's nothing more I could possibly do. You know, now we say things like, have a look in the mirror, do this, do that, record this. But darn it, people really aren't looking. So the thing is really to have someone, especially someone, you know, who's kind of kind and stuff, to kind of help you out. I think we're more into liaising with people. Now, of course, if you don't have that opportunity, you have to resort to other means. And what I will switch now to do is to have our ace compare put a little track on from a little lady who is slightly well known, and she's going to take us through her attempt at trying to bring some performance to a song. We'll discuss it briefly afterwards, if you like. Thank you, sir.
Isn't it rich? Are we a pair? Me here at last on the ground, you in midair. Send in the clouds. Isn't it bliss? Don't you approve? One who keeps tearing around, one who can't move. Where are the clouds? Send in the clouds. Just when I'd stopped opening doors, finally knowing the one that I wanted was yours, making my entrance again with my usual flair, sure of my line. No one is there. Don't you love fast? My fault, I fear. I thought that you'd want what I want. Sorry. Where are the clowns? There ought to be clowns. Don't bother. They're here. Isn't it rich? Isn't it queer? Losing my timing this late in my career. And where are the clowns? There ought to be clowns. Maybe next year.
Now, of course, there'll be a number of people who are wondering why I would possibly pick Judi Dench over, is it Jenny Mills? And there's a bunch of people who do this song quite magnificently. So you hear a whole thing, a whole swathe of emotion, and you get into the song and everything. But that's not what I chose that to discuss or to bring to light. I wanted to find something that in some way mirrored our group's capabilities. So the first thing is not to be concerned with, if you like, the quality of singing that you heard, or any foibles that may have occurred that you heard, or if it seemed disingenuous to you. What I wanted to get across is there's a ballad to deliver, and the ballads are always the hardest things to deliver, where you've got to try to convince people who are watching that you at least are interested in the song and that you're carrying the song. And she places herself with some unbelievable restrictions. Point number one as a restriction was, if you had any chance to pay attention to her hands, you know, what did she do with her hands? Did anyone notice? Unmute yourself and just say, if you noticed what she did with her hands.
She didn't do anything, I don't think, did she? Did she?
I don't know. What do people think? Did she do anything with her hands?
Yeah. I thought she just had them in a lap.
Yeah. Who else? One more.
Jane Wayne.
We weren't watching her hands. We're watching her face.
Uh-huh. That's right. That's right.
All about her face.
Say again, Donna.
She did one little move where she swept her hands, like,
yes, she did.
Around, sweep the room away.
Yes, it was done for dramatic effect, to throw away the stress and frustration of what she was trying to convey. The important thing I want to bring to us here is we have a number of tools. In You've Got a Friend in Me, we went all the way to not just getting our bodies engaged, our faces engaged, our voices engaged, with musical background. I mean, gosh, we're throwing it all in there. Okay? And then what do we do? We put costumes on. We bring dolls on. We bring teddy bears on, right? We couldn't bring any more into the scene, right? So and this goes completely the other way. So what are we going to do? What are you going to do? Judi Dench decided that she would not move her hands. That forced us to focus on her face. And all the tiny nuances, and I'm telling you, they're small. All the tiny nuances in there were all done to a strict plan. Don't for one second think she walked into that room and kind of just restricted herself with her hand movements and stood almost perfectly still on that chair and delivered something. She broke down the score. There are places dotted in the score, 8 immediate ones. Isn't it rich? As soon as she said, isn't it rich? Her whole face lit up to say, and her head moved up, because we equate rich, we equate wealth with higher standing. And this is a way to demonstrate, Justin, a small motion. This kind of thing happens all through the song. So she does the same thing. Isn't it bliss? And she says bliss, and she sweeps her head, and she holds on to the S's, right? So all the way through, you know, how does this relate to what we're doing? Especially for the beginning people, the tenors and basses of our current song. You've got to find something, and you do not have to find anything big. This is what I'm trying to get here. Okay? Less can be more. Mm-hmm. We've gone from extremes with You Got a Friend in Me. We are looking for less is more. Yep. Okay? This is the plan. I suggest that as you go through the score, you pick certain words that have emotion with them. Have you ever felt like nobody? Now, darn it. That is the first thing in that song that should immediately start going, oh my Lord, we have some to deliver. So if I'm watching you sing the song, which of course we're going to have to do in the video, I expect to see some sort of color that might be placed on your face, or a nuance, or a small look, or just, you know, a look down, something that symbolizes you understand that that's an important part. And this kind of thing goes through the whole score. Okay, there are moments dotted in there that all you have to do is believe and follow the lyrics and have something as a small thing you can add to the lyrics. Now we're running out of time, so I'm just gonna shut the heck up here and move right on. Thanks very much, people.
Thank you very much, Mike. Thank you. Again, it's a wonderful performance by Judy Dench. Just understated, but every little movement. And as Mike said, as an audience, it doesn't matter that it was planned, but he's right. There's nothing in that which was left to chance. It's been looked at. And again, as an audience member, I actually appreciate the work that went into that, that Judy Dench did to be able to do a performance in spite of not necessarily being the most virtuosic singer. It doesn't matter, because everything is understated, it's small, but it's so effective. But that, like you said, it's not just happenstance. You didn't just walk on stage with a frock and then just basically just blag it. There was a lot of work and planning and rehearsal and all those kind of things. So no, thank you very much, Mike. It was a great video. Folks, we come on to me now, and this is a little bit of a process. And again, it's not the only process, but it's a way that you can look to improve your performance. And it is using a mobile phone. Okay, so I'm going to talk you through, and if you've got a mobile phone now, that's fine, but you don't have to do this now. It's talking you through a process, and I'm just going to kind of then use a little bit of You Will Be Found, and we're just going to kind of look through how we might be able to use this. Now, a mobile phone, most mobile phones are very useful because they have two cameras. Okay, one, the selfie camera, and the one on the other side of your phone. That means that you can use a selfie camera to be able to see yourself. Now, people say, like, you want to sing into a mirror. Now, you will be able to, if you look into a mirror or your phone with a selfie cam on, you can actually see your performance. You can see whether it's believable. You can see what you look like. You can look at all those nuances. And as Mike said, You Will Be Found especially, but this is transferable to other songs. Once you've worked out what it is you want to feel, you need to make sure that you're either looking like you are feeling that, but not too much. Okay, you need to make sure, because if we're not feeling something, the idea of faking it, and again, honestly, that's not necessarily a bad thing. And when I say faking, I don't mean you're faking it. It might be that you're exaggerating the emotion you're feeling and you're adding in performance. It could be, however, that you are slightly towards kind of Debbie's default, which is to actually have to possibly rein in your emotional engagement. You'll be able to see that in a phone. You'll be able to see it in the screen. You'll be able to sing, and you'll be able to rehearse what that feels like and looks like. However, if you only ever sing into a mirror or you only ever sing into a phone, you will have no idea whether or not, when that phone or that phone is gone, or you're not looking in a mirror, whether or not you're still doing that when you've not got the instant visual feedback. Okay, it's why it's difficult. If you're talking to someone on the phone, for example, it's sometimes difficult. You can't see facial expression, and it's then quite difficult to know how they're feeling sometimes. Because you can't see them. If you can't see someone's face, we know a lot from people's faces, and that's including our own face. So what I would like you to do is you practice, and you don't practice the whole song. You pick a part of the song, and this is dependent on it depends on where you are on this scale. Are you someone who needs to put more emotion into a song? Are you someone who keeps themselves relatively controlled and finds it quite difficult to show emotion outwardly? Some of you will be. Okay, and that's absolutely fine. You're not going to change that default position. You're not suddenly going to become overly emotional just by, you know, watching yourself on a phone. You'll initially feel uncomfortable, but it's about what can you do to push yourselves further into the kind of Goldilocks zone of the middle, which is emotionally engaging, but still vocally in control and emotionally in control. If you are the other side of that scale, then you are going to be know that you're going to have to slightly find some of those things that Laura was saying to actually calm yourself down, to actually be able to still be emotionally involved, but not so that you start losing vocal control, losing breath control, and all those kind of things, or excess snot production, okay, which is always important. So it will be different things for you. You will generally know where you're more likely to be, okay? You will generally know. So I'm not going to give you one way of doing this. It depends which is your preference and what your kind of personality makes you do. But the idea of the phone is you watch yourself and then you record it, but you don't then watch it back. You straight away turn your phone round, check it's pointing at you, and you press record from the other side and you do the exact same phrase, but without being able to see yourself. And the aim of this is to perform so that you don't know which video is which. Does that make sense? So you can watch a video and there should be, if you've rehearsed it, because we're talking about rehearsal here. Yeah, we're talking about being able to rehearse these emotional passages and then deliver them with consistency, okay? Because the more you sing a song, if you always break down at the same point in the song every single time, you're not going to get a recording done. And it's cathartic giving in to the emotion, but it's not actually, we want to get through this song. The message of the song, we want to be there and we want the music to sound good. Because in the end of the day, we want the audience, the listener, to experience that emotion. We want to put that emotion to them. And if we can't get through the song, the emotion stays with us. We minimize the impact of that emotion. If it stays in us, we need to be able to give it to other people. Okay, so you watch back those videos, and if there is a difference between the two of them, then you can rehearse more. And I know the word rehearse, you might think, oh, well, you know, I'm gonna lose. If you are very emotional, and hence when you're looking at yourself, you're much more emotional than you are when you're not, or the other way around, you need to try and get consistency between those two things. Does that make sense? It's a really easy way of doing it. I've heard people do mirrors, but we all generally seem to have these phones. They are amazing things because you can watch yourself, you can then not watch yourself. And what we want you to do is be able to perform that way when you're not watching yourself, okay? Either being in control of those emotions enough to get the performance out and the vocals good, or you can push yourself slightly further emotionally, and you could do, but you don't have to see that you're doing it, which means if you then say, wow, I gave a brilliant performance, I was so emotionally engaged, and you watch the video back and basically it's gray and it's blank, you can tell. Yeah, there's no way that you'll watch a video back. And we're not talking about notes here. We're not talking about vocal quality. We're not talking about, like Mike said, we're not talking about that. You have the voice you have, and we want that to be as good as possible. We're talking about the visual, and that will transfer into the emotion of the notes. So that is a really simple way of doing it. Okay, so we're going to use the beginning of You Will Be Found. Okay, now I'm aware that you don't all sing the tune at the beginning of this, but I would like you to sing the tune at the beginning of You Will Be Found. Okay. Even if you sing an octave up, okay? This is a tricky section. If you're not a tenor or a bass, it's tricky. If we think about the words at the beginning of You Will Be Found, okay? You have to be able to make a switch from, I'm going to use very, very generic terms of emotion, sad, to happy and hopeful. And you've got about 3 seconds to do it. So from a performance point of view, you have to be, have you ever felt like nobody was there? Yeah, have you ever felt forgotten in the middle of nowhere? Have you ever felt like you could disappear, like you could fall and no one would hear? You're alone, and that's a powerful start to a song, okay? Loneliness, emptiness, that your life doesn't matter, and that if you weren't here anymore, no one would even miss you. No one would even notice you weren't there. In 3 seconds, in one word, you have to be able to change that performance. The word well. Okay, and I've been doing youth sessions every single day for the last couple of weeks, and that's the point. That very point, you have to turn it on the word well. Well, let that lonely feeling wash away. And that's hope. But you cannot, therefore, fall off the cliff. You can't fall off the cliff in that first phrase because you've got 3 seconds and you've got to give someone hope. Okay, this is not a song about being alone. It is not a song about hopelessness. It's not that. It has elements of that, but only so we can, you know, we don't really understand the darkness until we've experienced the light. And that's the whole point of this, that it starts off in that darkness and there, but it's saying, no, doesn't have to be that way. People are there for you. Okay, so, but then there's a different emotion then, is that then you've got this happy, hopeful emotion, which then for some of you may also then be a little bit like a wash of emotion. So you go from kind of sad town, and then suddenly you're in hopeful, happy town, but you've still got to then get through the next, so you need to practice these things and to look about what you need to tap into. So we're going to go through the first phrase of this song a couple of times. I do have a Blue Peter version in a bit, which is take 7. Of my work today. I did 12 takes of the initial part of this song, 5 of them with watching myself, 7 of them without watching myself, and I went with take 7 was the most successful one of that, just to the first 30 seconds of the song. But before that, and I'm happy with it. I'm pretty happy with it. It's about the right kind of thing for me, and I followed this exact program of, it was on my computer as opposed to my phone. Watch myself, don't watch myself. Watch myself, don't watch myself. And I just did that. Okay, so what we're going to do is, I'd like to go through the beginning part of the song. I'm only going to share sound. Okay, and I'm also, and again, it just depends how well you know the song, I'm also going to just share the instrumental. So there's no singing in this. Okay, so it's just the piano part and the instrumental. You may well struggle with timing. And you know what? I don't care. Okay, you're singing on mute, but I would like you, if you want to mute, if you want to turn your camera off, that's absolutely fine. But I'd like to go through the first part of this session, section of the song, and I would like you to try and involve yourself in the sad emotion at the beginning, but still leave the light on, leave the light of hope, and start trying to practice how you then switch that on the word well. And if you use the word well, you need to smile on that note, okay? Because that's your hope, that's your light in the darkness, and that's what you need to hold on to. Okay, so let's try this. I'm just going to share my sound but not my screen, and we'll give this a go. You're all on mute, and we'll just go through from the beginning. I'm going to put myself on mute because I'm going to sing along too, and you definitely don't want to be hearing me. Give me a thumb when you can hear it. And I know there's a want to continue. The problem of this song is every time you get to the end of a phrase, you want to carry on in the song. Okay, I'm going to do that for you once more. Now, some of you may have been looking at yourself on the screen, and that's absolutely fine. Okay, when you're in Zoom sessions, you can watch yourself. it's I know it might seem egotistical to watch yourself. I do it all the time. But you want to practice watching yourself. You may also want to watch other people, because you may well be drawn to other people. You don't need to tell them, but you may be drawn to other people's performances. You can feed off other people's emotions. It's okay. But eventually you need to make sure that you're practicing so you can do that without that visual aspect of somebody else or your own face. Okay? Let's try that again. Here we go. Exactly the same bit. This is all work practice, so this is not, you're not going to get it right now. It takes rehearsal. 12 takes for me. So here we go. Okay, folks. Now, again, it's just a very small part of the song, but it just hopefully highlights that in a very small, short part of the song, you have to be able to change your emotion. If we if we fall off the cliff to one kind of emotion in a song, we will not be able to give the audience the next kind of emotion. This is still a complex song. There's a complex amount of emotions, okay? It's not just, I mean, most emotional songs are three-dimensional. They're not just happy or sad. Yeah, so now I'm just going to quickly share you. I said I would. I'll share with you take 7. Okay, this is me singing live. I did add a little bit of reverb because I'm pretentious like that. So you'll just have to forgive me. Okay, here we go. Can you see? Just give me a thumb up if you can see my screen. Excellent. Okay. Oh, sorry. Take 4 of 7. It's take 4 of 7 that I did without watching myself. Here we go. It's about what I can do at the beginning of this song. Any more, I fall off the cliff. Any less, I think I can always do a little bit more.
Simon, it's very garbled.
Yeah, I'm just going to wait for 2 seconds. I just had some internet issues, I think. 1 second. Let me know. Can you hear me okay through your microphone? Can you hear my speech okay? Okay, I'll try again. Might have just been a short-term issue. If not, it's always on the PowerPoint, but I'll try once more. So just let me know.
Still doing it, mate.
Still dodgy. Okay, that's a shame. Well, I'm going to therefore say to you, let me just wonder. In fact, can I ask a favor? Just to try. Could you all turn your cameras off? Supposedly, if you turn your camera off, it frees up my internet capability. Don't worry if you can't turn your camera off. If most people do, it might. So just let me know. It may be a rumor that if people turn camera off, it gives a bit more internet quality. So somebody give me a thumbs up if it is slightly better quality.
Have you ever felt like nobody was there? Have you ever felt forgotten in the middle of nowhere? Have you ever felt like you could disappear? Like you could fall and no one would hear? Well, let that lonely feeling wash away. Maybe there's a reason to believe you'll be okay. 'Cause when you don't feel strong enough to stand, you can reach out your hand, and oh, someone will come.
Cool. So that was my take 4 of 7. You can put your cameras back on now. Thank you. It seemed that that did a did make a slight difference to my internet capabilities. Who knew that having 50 people's video feeds on my on this would make a difference? So I was close. I'll be honest, I was close. There was other takes, and actually at that point, take 4 of 7 was the one. Okay, and it doesn't mean the last one you do will be the one. What I did was I pushed it a little bit far. Take 6 was a little bit snotty. Let's just put it that way. Take 7 was far. I went too far the other way. So you always have to, and I'm still learning, you always will be one side of the cliff or the other. My first couple of takes were a little bit, they weren't as engaging. I could go further towards the cliff. But take 6, I fell off the cliff. Take 7, I stayed away from the cliff entirely. And take 4 was the best one I did today. But that was just a couple of hours ago, and I was relatively happy with that. When I watched that back, there's a few note things, but as a performance and a visual thing, that's about what I can do at the moment, and we have to be kind to ourselves. Are there people who will be able to perform that better? 100%. Are there people who would be able to sing that better? 100%. Does that matter? 100% not. Because if that's the best I can do, all you can do is the best performance you can do. If that means that just by increasing your emotion by 2 or 3%, or lowering it by 2 or 3%, if that's progress, then that's brilliant. And you can only be as emotionally involved as you can, or you can only control yourself emotionally as much as you can. All we ask is you try that, and you try out some of these tips, some of these tricks, and some of these things. You've got that PowerPoint there for you to be able to go and look at some of those videos, to be able to experience that, and you will know whether or not you're the emotional type or the non-emotional type, and you know which direction you need to travel in to get into, as I said, the Goldilocks zone of performance, which is under control but affecting others emotionally while being just about in control yourself. Is that all okay, folks? Well, thank you so much, folks. It's been 90 minutes. I said it'd be a 90-minute session. It's exactly 90 minutes. Or is it 2.5? No, it's 1.5. I think it is 1.5, not 2.5 hours. I suddenly worried. Now, thank you so much, folks. Really, really appreciated. I'd like just to say a big thanks to Donna and Laura and Mike and Debbie for all their kind of hard work on this and all that discussion. So well done to them. Hopefully it's been of use and of interest. Obviously the recording will be up there for you. And what we want you to do is have an experiment. Go and try this out. Use your phone, watch it, and see how you do. Okay, and really, really good luck with it. If you want to share, and this is honest, if you want to, in text form or whatever, share how you're doing and let us know how you're doing. And if any of these things work, please, please do. We'd love to hear how you're doing, to give you a bit of support. But please remember that thing at the beginning that Laura said, please be kind to yourself. Okay, we do not want to put you under too much pressure emotionally. Do this when you can. And if you need to step away from a song for at any point, please do. Don't put yourself in any kind of issues that will affect you. Donna Walsh.
Can I just remind everybody that One Voice is being premiered at 10 p.m. UK time.
2 hours.
Tonight. Two hours from now. It is going to be fantastic. And we'll see you all there.
Indeed. Laura.
Can I just remind everyone to bring your headphones to watch it? It will give...
There is some stuff with One Voice where you want to have a pair of headphones on if you can. There's some stereo stuff that happens which may well make it a lot more interesting for you to listen to. The YouTube link is going up very, very soon before, because there's no way of doing a YouTube premiere without it being public, and I didn't want it to be public. What I'm doing is I'm only putting the link up on YouTube about 15 minutes before it's going to go live. and I'll then put it on the Facebook group, because if it goes in there for too long, people who aren't in the collective will hear it, and we don't want too many people hearing it before we do our own video. It's not a problem if a couple of people do, but that's just why there isn't a video link there on YouTube yet. There will be. The video's there, but I haven't set it to premiere yet, so I'll do that just before time. Thank you so much, folks. Have a wonderful evening. Enjoy 10 o'clock when you hear one voice, and thanks very much again. Take care. Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye.
Thanks, everyone.
Thank you. Bye, folks.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. I'm going to wave until everyone's gone. 35, 34, 32, 31, 30, 29, 28, 27, 26, 25, so many people leaving. They must not like me. I blame Mike. It's Mike. They didn't like Mike. No, it was Laura. They didn't like Laura. They didn't like Debbie. No, they didn't like Donna. Nah.
Everyone loves Debbie.
Yeah, everyone. What do you mean? What about everyone loves Debbie? What about me? Cool.
Yeah, but everyone loves Debbie.
I'm still waving bye.
Bye.
Hello, Lynn.
And Debbie. And Mike. And Donna.
Bye, Lynn.
Bye.
I love Simon.
I'm kicking your money out now. You've not left. I'm going to have a team meeting now. One second here. One's gone. And it's
bye,
just,
Donna.
See you later. Bye. Lynn. Take care, my love.
Bye. Take care, Lynn.
Bye. Lynn.
Bye.
We'll see you again. We'll see you again, Lynn. Press that button, Lynn. Press
no, I'm not going. I'm staying.
Well, I'm removing staying. You. I'm going to give you 5 seconds until I move you.
Oh, four, bugger. Bugger.
Three. Two.
Bye, Lynn.
One. Gone.
That was fantastic.
She's gone.
That was fantastic.
Oh, I love it. It's like, I can be nice, but I am going to remove you eventually.
Uh-huh. Yeah, I know. You got a countdown, and she said no.
A countdown? Saying no doesn't stop me. It's like, no, please don't remove me. Gone.
That's the well, best exit I've ever seen.
Yesterday.
Did she?
Exactly. Oh. Yeah. Well done, folks. I think that seemed to go relatively well.